Boom, there it is. How about that, guys? Welcome to At Home with Wes. I'm your host, Wes Taylor, America's General Contractor. Together, we're bridging the gap between homeowners and their homes. Hey, Ruben, can you give me a little more of my ears, brother? We didn't do a sound check. Here's the thing. Ruben's prepared, like, every day. He's in the booth. He knows how to push the buttons. He knows exactly what to do. And I'm down in the kitchen, like, down the hall. He's like, yeah, I'll use the restroom. We wanted to make sure that we didn't have really long commercial breaks. So I thought, well, that's great. That'd be great for everybody, except for me, because then there's no break, in, you know, and you get the coffee and all this other stuff going. So I'm flying down the hall. I hear the music coming out of the deal. So I run into the broadcast room where I am now. And Ruben's just kind of in there relaxing. He's like, are you ready? So we didn't get time to do a sound check. But it still sounds great anyway. Thanks, Ruben. You there, brother? No. Oh, yeah, there he is. Got it. Good. All right, guys, so what we do here is we bridge the gap between, or the many gaps between homeowners and their homes. It's about quality of life, and it's about everything important to you and how it all comes together there in that most important place to you, and that's home. So we'll do concepts, we'll have guests in here, I'll give you tips. The best thing that we do, like when we have guests, the best thing about that is you get to see contractors or providers or service folks or products from the perspective of the provider. And you don't get to do that when you're a homeowner oftentimes. And because, you know, you're there and you're going through, we'll go through the bid process. And gosh, I just hope it doesn't cost too much. I hope it gets done, you know, quickly. And I hope we get a quality job. And we're going to talk a little about that today as well. But I like you to see what it's like on the other person's perspective. I'm fortunate enough that I've had my foot firmly in the camp of the end user, whether it be a homeowner or as a large general contractor, real estate developer. I'm like you. I'm on the buying end of services from subcontractors, or you call them tradesmen when you call them, like need a heating and air guy or need a plumber or something like that. And I've got to buy their services, just like you do. So I got really good at it because I buy the stuff, you know, obviously on a much larger scale. But also, I've been the provider of services. And I don't cut corners. It's like Chris or Philip Nappy with Vavia or Jason Young with All Phase Guttering. We don't cut corners. We do it right. We do it with the right people. We use the right products. And I think that's one of the things that people forget when they're contracting, because they just want it the cheapest they can get it. You want cheap? You can get cheap. But you think about what you do for a living. Do you want to get paid as cheaply as possible for your hard work? I know our demographic. You're not just a bunch of lazy people sitting around. You're probably working this morning. If not, you're listening and you're maybe opening up shop, or you're driving because you're making a living. You're working. You're doing it. No, we need to pay you the cheapest. All right, so that's somewhat my rant. I've got a few more in the can for us today, Ruben. But overall, it's going to be a pretty positive experience here this morning. If you all want to contact me, it's really easy. Wes at Radio Wes. You can do that. How easy? Wes at Radio Wes. We are also really close to launching the new website. It's awesome. Getting ready to film also our second online course. We haven't even launched the first course, and people are already taking it. How about that? And that one's called Before You Buy. And it's everything that you, as a buyer, or you as a realtor, want to know or need to know about a house or property before you buy it. We get a home inspection. These are things that the home inspector probably won't or maybe can't report on. And we were going to have Dan Rousseau on today. There was a conflict of timing, so he'll be on with us one of these times coming up very soon. And Ruben, how much time do you think we have left, brother?
We got approximately 4 minutes.
Sweet. You know, this segment, it's the shortest of the four. I call them quarters. But this one always goes by so fast. And then you and I start talking, solving the world's problems. And before you know it, we've got to get off the air. And
this is true. This is how it goes. Solve the world's problems. And hey,
you know,
got to go. Problems make money.
You being a major podcaster, and we're going to come to you for some tips, because we're going to start podcasting in addition. And my days, by the way, at this microphone are probably numbered. I want to partner with iHeart in some different ways, reach more people on their schedule, kind of like what you do. Anyway.
Okay, I hear you.
But we got a few shows left or whatever, but we're still going to do it. And iHeart's still going to be responsible for bringing it to you. It's a great organization. You being in, with what you do, what about this Elon Musk thing, buying Twitter?
Sounds like they're going to try to not let him buy it. My question is why they don't want him to buy it.
You know, and
minus the money, monetarial aspect of it. And I think, you know what, now that I think about it, I think I might know my I might know why. They say something like he's going to try to take it private. I didn't know that you could take a company public, then take it back private. Is that what can happen?
I guess.
I don't know. That's kind of interesting, but
we got to talk. I'll ask Gary Gwynn. Gary is he's one of we're going to give him a shout out today. He's like the ultimate banker, businessman, great friend, great guy, great family guy, type of guy we like to have on the air. He's with Pinnacle Financial, and we'll give his number out a little bit later. Pinnacle Bank, Green Hills. But you know, Ruben, what I always wondered was if you're on Facebook or Twitter or any of these major mediums, and you're cutting out or controlling the speed or the transmission of communication, and you're going to halt that or cut these guys out or cut that guy out, you are ostracizing 2/3 of the population. Open it up. You could make, you think Zuckerberg is rich now? If they didn't have all this policing and all this crap, can you imagine how wealthy he would be? Same with Twitter. And I think that maybe that's what's going on.
I don't know. I think I might have a differing opinion, or not necessarily a differing opinion. I might look at it another way, or better yet, I can really see it from both ways. I see what you're saying, and then I think I kind of see where they're coming from as well. The days of the Wild Wild West of internet,
yeah,
is I don't know. I don't think it is what it once was, but I don't think it's to where it's like television, you know.
Well, it's everything's fluid like time. I mean, surgeons are going to be coming around, you know, 100 years from now saying they were really barbaric back then.
Yeah.
But we're
yeah.
like, man, grandpa had a heart attack. He was dead. You have a heart attack today. You put the thing and go back on the NFL field.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. Just like tearing an ACL back when I was a kid, at least, 20 years ago, it was like death sentence. Like, you're not playing anymore. And then I saw a guy, his name is Sean. He played for the Golden State Warriors.
Yeah.
I can't think of his last name. But he had a torn ACL, like, real early in his career. And then next thing you know, he's world champion. So, yeah, needless to say, I understand where you're coming from.
When Derrick Henry had his surgery, when he came up to you, did you get to talk to him about that? Oh, that's right. He hadn't talked to you. He's afraid of you.
I was just about to say, like, me and Derrick, you know, he kind of keeps it on the hush-hush these days.
We're going to do something here. I'm going to do several shout-outs during the second quarter, and I want you to have usually you're driving along, you're working or whatever, and say, you don't keep a pencil with you. I don't keep a pencil with me. I've got one right now. That's because I make notes as I go. I'm going to give you a bunch of shout-outs of some really cool providers, and then we've got a call coming in today from my adopted little sister, Diane Canada, the very famous Diane Canada. She'll be calling in around, I guess, 8:25, 8:30, something like that. We'll have her on, talk about her remodel and at her house and going into it was like coming out of it and looking back what it's like. That'd be really cool. Plus, we want to talk about her new entity, see how that's turning out. So glad to be with you here live Saturday morning. And Ruben, good to be with you too, brother. I'm Wes Taylor, and we'll be back in a couple minutes. Rarely use notes now. I just come in because I know where I want to go. And I think having you there, sometimes having a guest, that helps too. Want to keep it kind of conversational. I don't care how informational or factual something is when you're listening to it or watching it. If it's not entertaining, yada yada. I'm not gonna listen.
Don't let the facts get in the way of a story.
Well, welcome to the media.
Yeah, come on, not the truth. Come on.
Well, that's right. And I think the majority of the world kind of knows this, you know, tongue in cheek and so forth. Ruben, let me ask you this before you go away, because I know you get really busy in there. Are you garden or like plants, things like that?
That type of gardening. No, I don't.
So I'm where, first of all, I can grow just about it. I can grow grass on a shoe.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
That's impressive.
Oh, yeah. That's how good we are.
That's impressive. Right there.
But I am where poinsettias go to die.
Just that specific one.
That specific. The red ones. Not the white ones, the red ones.
I thought poinsettias were purple. Maybe. See, this is how you know I don't know nothing about gardening. You're welcome.
Purple. No, that's roses.
No, I know that's not it.
So Like, I had some friends who were like, hey, you want to, we're going out of town. I lived across the street. Any chance you could come by and just, like, check on the poinsettias and water the ficus while we're gone? Okay, sure, yeah. How long are you going to be gone? 2 months.
Wow.
Okay, yeah. And so, like, a week into it, I was like, how am I going to explain that all these poinsettias are dead? I did exactly what they said. Maybe it's kind of a mojo thing.
Well, you know what? Plants do absorb energy.
They're people, too, you know.
Like, what was I looking at? I think I was looking at Mr. Wizard when I was a kid or something. See, do you know anything about Mr. Wizard? Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. I was looking at Bill Nye the Science Guy or Mr. Wizard or something like this. And this was the experiment. No, seriously.
He got me again. Do not watch him when he's talking.
Seriously. Like, they screamed at the plant.
And what happened?
The plant eventually, it started to wilt. I'm not saying that you have bad energy. I'm not saying that at all. I am saying that plants absorb energy. So the energy that from the person that bought them not being there may have led.
They yelled at the plants.
I'm not saying that. But that is what happened. They yelled at the
plants. There's a lot of things that wilt when they're yelled at.
Exactly. And plants are one of them.
Yeah, relationships. That's what I'm talking about. Could be anything.
Oh, well, that too. Yeah. But what I'm saying is the person wasn't there that. So it's different energy. So now, next thing you know.
You know, I got this.
Okay, it didn't sound good in my head. It didn't come out right, I guess.
I wish that we had a camera on you. That would sell this whole thing.
No cameras.
No, see camera. No, how do you know I don't have one on you? Look at that. Oh, on the back of this computer right here. Oh, yeah.
You know what?
It's watching you.
You got me.
Because these people think that this guy just laughs. They can't see what they.
I think that might be the beauty of it. I'm kind of like the dude on Home Improvement. Like, you can't see my face, like the neighbor.
Yeah, the guy on, what was his name?
Neighbor? Wilson, okay. I thought it was neighbor.
They named him after a basketball, after a volleyball.
Yeah, so I'm like the Wilson of your show. So they can hear me, just can't see me.
Even what's really funny is that most of the time I can only kind of see the top half of you, kind of very much like that television show. That was like Tool Time. It was Tim Taylor.
Yeah.
From Detroit.
Home Improvement.
Yeah. So... I used to do like a huge garden, like where I'd get my heavy equipment out and get the land. I was like on your acre, make half of it, and that was real fun for like the first couple months. And then this was over in East Nashville, by the way, when after the first tornado, way back, when you got shot in your front yard. So
wow, okay, yeah. Now those were the days.
And everybody around me, they didn't particularly care for my politics or lawn signs, but like, if you have the community garden, we'll all help and we'll all pitch in and we'll all partake of the bounty. Right? Well, you know where this is going. So I do the garden. I'm out there. I get home from the office. I'm out there weeding, and I'm weeding, and I'm watering, and I'm fertilizing. Not one person ever showed up to help. This is a huge garden.
Okay.
Like, you could take off in the morning in your car, and by the afternoon, you're at the other side of it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
You did say it was sizable.
So, but by the minute it started producing, they started showing up. Yeah, like, oh, yeah, we just came to get some tomatoes. Oh, we just came to, where were you?
Like it was nothing.
Well, it's pretty typical. I mean, it's just,
that's
a microcosm of what's going out there in the world right now.
Yeah, that's life in a.
So I've got this time I did a raised bed. I've got like a small greenhouse. It's not a big, it's like maybe 5 by 10, 12 feet long. But it's good enough. And you don't put Miracle-Gro on like a seedling. It doesn't need it. God created them to survive. Mm-hmm. All right, so I got this box of Miracle-Gro out there. What could possibly go wrong? I've got the disc missing. So my hands, once in a while, everything just, sometimes I just fall. The nervous system just dies. So I've got to be real careful on the ladder. So I got this box. It drops out of my hand. It's open. And like if you drop like a glass of milk or something or coffee, if it hits directly on the bottom of the cup or the mug, what's ever in it comes up like a big mushroom cloud.
Mm-hmm.
So I dropped the Miracle-Gro, every flake of it went everywhere. How do you get it up? You can't.
I'm just about to say, yeah, that's
so. I did a little bit of raking. Then I just said, I'm just going to water it and water it and water it and water it. So that'll dilute it and it'll go down below the earth's surface.
Mm-hmm.
No. Damn. Next day, the plants were all dead. So I removed a bunch of dirt, planted it again. Next day, they're all dead. I'm like, this is Fort Zayton Vrain nuclear area. Right.
So you over Miracle-Gro the area.
Yeah, think. So anyway, so I last weekend I removed all the dirt, everything, and I started over.
That sucks.
Old man winter hung on for a long time. I can't believe you go to like a hardware store, one of the big box stores. You can't go from aisle to aisle. Builders can't do that anymore in the store anyway, because they're like Walmarts. You know, buy the flashlights, buy the tool set, the little happy pink handled starter set. Mm-hmm. So builders just don't go there anymore. And try to go through like one of those places now. It's nothing but plants. Everybody's planting. I think they're afraid, you know, they're probably afraid the food supply is getting cut off. I'll probably grow my own.
I mean, it's funny that you say that, because I was reading something. I won't get into what I was reading. But, especially because you might have my face on camera. But, yeah, growing food and knowing how to grow food and hunting and all those things are essential.
Oh, yeah.
Very much essential to survival. And we should know more about these things. And I wish they would teach some of these things in school.
You know what? You know, you and I, we're a strange team. People just wouldn't have put us together. We're just so different. We see so many things absolutely eye to eye. And what we can communicate about this stuff, because we care about each other.
Yeah.
I mean, that's sort of at the core of all of it. You got to respect yourself. Got to respect the other guy.
Quite honestly, I think everybody in America has the same value. And when I say value, I specifically made it singular for a reason. I think everybody in America has the same thought process of what they want. It's just how they get there is the interesting part.
No, I would agree with you, with one exception to that. Then the other half of the people are mentally ill.
Okay, well, some of them.
We get some little middle ground there.
You know, it's funny, because I was about to say, I was about to liken this to traveling. Yeah. And then I'll be quiet. I think I'm getting too wordy now. Yeah. I think it's the caffeine and the tea. I was about to say, you know, some people want to go through, if you're in Memphis and you want to get to Atlanta, some people go through Mississippi and Alabama, then some people come through Nashville. And
yeah.
Well, then those people that you speak of, like, try to go through Indianapolis or something. And it's like, okay, but what, 80% are trying to go through Nashville and Alabama, but then you got
the guy who goes through Alaska to get here.
True.
Because it feels good.
Yeah.
You know, while we're on this whole gardening thing, there was something I wanted to talk about. A lot of people don't know this. A lot of people do, but let's just get into some real quick basics. When I go and I look at a fertilizer at a store, and I need to buy a fertilizer, say we're going to do something like weed and feed for the yard, or we're going to do maybe a fertilizer-based potting soil, something like that, or we're in mid-season in growth, I want to make sure that the roots are strong, or that the leaves are bigger, we can get a little bit more light, plant does better. Those numbers, those three numbers on the side of a fertilizer bag, they're letters. It's N, P, and K, right? The N, it stands for nitrogen, and there'll be a number next to it, like, say, 20% nitrogen. And then at P and K, it'll say 0 and 0. Well, this thing is designed for one reason, and that's to make it green and help the leafy part of it, or, in other words, like weed and feed. The only one it's got in there is nitrogen, and that's designed to make your leaves, the grass blades, taller, stronger, and greener, right? And there's a weed killer in there, too. So then the P is for phosphorus. And the phosphorus is what makes the root system stronger. And that's important in certain parts of the country where it can be harder to establish a good root system. Farmers know how important this is. And then there's the K, which on the periodic table, that's potassium. And the potassium is there to support like a real vigorous growth and a hardiness to make the plant strong or keep it healthy. So those are the three ingredients. And whatever you're doing, you read up on whatever plants you're doing or herbs or whatever you're going to do, read up on it. Find out what you need. Find out what kind of fertilizer you need. And keep in mind what those three letters are on the sides. Now, Ruben, I have a stopwatch. He gives me a little notice. What, really? We had two left? This one flew by. We're going to should be calling in at any time. It's going to be our guest today. And I cannot wait for her to come on the air. I love her, Diane Canada. So we've got 2 minutes left. Here's a couple shout-outs right now. First one, guys, there's a company out there. It's run by a guy and his wife. And it's Mark and Helen, and the company's called Helen's Pop Art. I know that sounds interesting, Helen's Pop Art. And their website is helenspopart.com, and I don't think it's apostrophe S, it's just Helen's Pop Art. They have got, I saw last week their new product, they've got these T-shirt designs that are like guitars and then the city skyline of Nashville. But I've not, you know, I've seen that before. But I'm talking the way they do it's so artistic. And they're at Opryland, but that's not where I saw them. I saw them at Farmer's Market. And in fact, they're there today and tomorrow. When you go through there and you see the guy with the really cool t-shirts and hats, that's them. Tell them I said hi. First of all, guys, I'm Wes Taylor, America's General Contractor. Together, we're bridging the gap between homeowners and their homes. We do it every Saturday. I love being with you. I'm a live talker. I think we connect better that way. You can always contact me, Wes, at Radio Wes. It's pretty easy. Well, you got to put a .com at the end of it. Come on, Wes at Radio Wes. And you can also contact me on my new email address, and that is Wes at home with Wes. You got to put a little space in between the at, because I think you started Wes at. So Wes at home with Wes. That's pretty easy. Love your emails. I don't bring them on air. I guess I probably should. But hey, listen. One of the things that we haven't talked about, and we got our guest who's just about to come on. One of the things we don't talk about, we really haven't talked about windows yet, really, windows replacement. I've touched on a few things. You know, there's so many important things when it comes to your windows. There is, obviously, the quality of them. You can't just get new windows and say, oh, well, they were $300, and it's like, we had new windows, now we can expect our bills to go down, because it doesn't work that way. There are certain types of windows that behave certain types of ways. You always want to make sure you get low E, and everybody says, well, what that mean? That means low energy loss, right? That means they perform very well. They're filled with argon gas. They're made, they aren't just painted, it's through and through. And one of my friends, Anthony, has a amazing new window company. They're making huge strides. I'm going to deal with them exclusively. You all thinking about new windows, you can just get in touch with them. And his name's Anthony, okay? You can reach him at 615, always. Call Anthony at 750-3376, 750-3376, replacementwindowcenter.com, replacementwindowcenter. Doesn't get easier than that. Now, really excited because I view this, our next guest that's coming up, I view as, I was going to say kind of John, a female John Wayne on crack, but she's not going to like that, but as like a real super person. This is the greatest sister somebody could have. It's the greatest wife I may could have. It's the greatest mother. It's the greatest neighbor. It's the greatest leader. And I'm going to talk to her a little bit about that, because she was like about to run for president for a little while. And like, she didn't have enough support. It was like 40, 50 million people was all she had. Unbelievable. Is she there? Okay. Diane Canada, are you there?
Hey, Wes, I'm here. Hey, that's some high praise. Thank you.
No, look, I was just kidding about all that. So are you, tell me what you're doing right now. What are you wearing? Where are you sitting? What are you doing?
Oh my gosh.
Yep.
Do I know you well enough for you to ask me that question? I'm just kidding.
Well, wait a minute. It depends on what the answer is. Maybe not.
I am drinking a cup of coffee.
There you go. Ding.
At my dining room table, and I'm looking out my beautiful windows to my backyard that I love up here in the country.
Oh my gosh. That's kind of what I figured. I'm picturing you there. Thank you, first of all, for getting up. Well, I know you're up probably 4 or 5 in the morning anyway, because you're a doer. But thanks for coming on and spending a little time doing this. I wanted to do a follow-up with you. We had you on the air. You were going to come in. In fact, you and your awesome husband. But we had like, it was 18 feet of snow that night. And
oh, my gosh, it was a blizzard. Yeah, it was like we had like the bottom fell out of the sky that day when, I was going to come in a couple months back and didn't dare brave the long, windy road down the mountain. I'm like, I love you, Wes, but
yep.
I want to end up off a cliff somewhere.
Well, I know we can do call-ins. Heck, I could open up the phone lines now, but we don't do that because when we exhaust a subject or subject matter, we're on a certain track. And if somebody were to call in and say, like, hey, I got a roof leak, what do I do about it? Well, go to YouTube or call a roofer, because 98% of our listeners don't have a roof leak. I'm not going to waste 5 to 7 minutes of a segment, which is a segment, on a call that's not applicable. When I have you on the air, let's back up. This is why, another reason I wanted you to be my guest. Can you tell us a little bit about when you and I met, what were you doing at that time politically?
Running for State House of Representatives.
And it was pretty close, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was very, it shocked me and shocked everybody how close that came. It was really close, 46% as a first-time candidate in a very progressive district. I'm very open about the fact that I'm conservative, and yeah, I was running in a pretty progressive district, and
unbelievable.
Yeah, everybody kind of expected me to come in at like 18, 20. They expected him to kind of leave me in the dust, but
no,
yeah,
Diane,
the favor of God, though.
Look, I'm a firm believer. I still believe in this country. I'm not loaded down with the crap. Yeah, I know there's a lot of evil out there, and you know that too. But if you talk to people, like Ruben and I do, you got to talk mm-hmm. to them. If you really care and if you're really a good person, you're going to listen. And too many people are like, well, it's a hard day at work. I've got to be out of town tomorrow. I'm going to sit down, have a beer, watch the game. No, no. And when too many people do that, let's just catch the highlights. Well, Elon Musk is a terrible man. Well, you know, Facebook is a terrible man. And you don't get to know the people. You're in a progressive district. You did so well because you talk to people. You have to talk to people.
Well, this is, you know, you talk about, this is a show about home, right?
Yep.
And I mean, yes, we have physical homes. And like you say, if we just kind of stay in them, we don't ever, like God says, take, you know, step out of your tent, you know, once in a while.
Yeah.
I miss that sense of community in America. And I really think that we've got to start focusing more on our American home. You know, I think America is in a huge identity crisis right now.
Yeah.
And people are just sort of opting out of relationship. And we can't do that. Like, we do that. And I mean, it's not about partisanship. It's not about left or right. It's like, you know, we're all Americans. We're all an American family, and we need to start acting like it.
I've got some friends who are uniquely Democrats, or they're Democrats, or they're progressives, or they're liberals. I absolutely love these people, and they love me too. And I've got friends who are, you know, they probably think I'm too liberal, but I've got conservative friends too, and I'm a believer. And but we get along and we love each other because we're human beings. And Well, I was just going to say, when we talk about home, I've done that before. Where are you from? Well, I live on Oneida Street. Or where are you from? Well, we're from, you know, Missouri. Or where are you from? Well, I'm from the United States. I mean, yeah, so it is home. It's part of our home. Go ahead. We got, what about 30 seconds? 45? Oh, we can keep going? Okay, good. Diane, be long-winded. Go ahead.
Well, you know, it's Holy Week, right? And we're in Easter weekend. And I put up a Facebook post yesterday that, you know, that I'd never really seen it that way before. It just kind of came out of me when I was writing the caption for it, that, you know, Jesus loved us enough to not only crawl up on a cross for us and take an unimaginable, brutal beating and death, right?
Yeah.
But he actually was able to love and forgive the very people that were nailing him to that cross. He actually said, "Forgive them, Father. They know not what they do." We all have blind spots. We all have areas in our life that we just don't see things clearly. And our neighbors, our friends, our neighbors, our community, we all are guilty of that. I mean, how many times in our lives have we, you know, discovered something later and then kind of went back and said, "Oh my God, what was I thinking?" Or "How did you put up with me?" Or what, you know. So if Jesus loved us enough to forgive the very people nailing him to that cross this weekend, we can forgive and love each other for far less than that.
You know, I'm so glad you said, I did see that post. I may have responded, but my biggest, a lot of folks listening who knew me when I was a child, and we've been reunited as well. My biggest growth intellectually, emotionally, illumination was when I understood what real forgiveness is. Not just, look, I forgive you, and then you bring it up, you know, 20 minutes later, is to, when you've been wronged, when you've really been wronged, because that's where you could, that's a great, when you are hurt by somebody or something so badly, that's the perfect opportunity to learn forgiveness. You've got to understand you've got to understand that you didn't walk in the shoes that created what they are. You may not understand what it is, or you have empathy. This is a human. Can you imagine what horrible things have they survived or not survived to get to the point of wronging me this badly? And that's sort of the lesson, I think, that you're... But if you can forgive... And then all of a sudden, I'm like, I see this person as a human, an injured human. I can forgive you. I'm not putting you back in charge again, Adolf Hitler. But, I think that's how
thing.
It works.
I learned years ago, somebody said, I think it was Joyce Meyer, somebody said something that really hit me. It's just because you forgive... I mean, Jesus requires us to forgive, right? He forgave us. We are required to forgive. Forgiveness doesn't mean that you're saying what they did was okay to you. I mean, I've been through some incredible betrayals and very difficult roads, and I'm sure I know for a fact that you have too. It's not saying that I'm letting you off the hook, and you know what you did was okay.
Yeah, you owe me $1,000. I'll take $200,000. We'll call it even.
Forgiveness says, I'm taking my hands off your throat, and I'm leaving you to Jesus. And your feelings, you may not feel like it, but it's an act of obedience, and your feelings may not catch up. I mean, I have some people in my life, I've forgiven them, but my feelings haven't fully caught up yet.
Listen, earlier I talked to you about my good friend Gary Gwynn over at Pinnacle Financial, Pinnacle Bank, Green Hills. Gary is the guy, guys, when I need a mortgage or I need investment advice, I've got him, I've got my guys at Raymond James as well. But it would be great to have Gary Gwynn on your team. And I finally found his numbers, guys. My bad. 615-743-6104. Call if anything you need financially, 743-6104. Old Nashville's been here a long time. We got a lot of mutual friends from way back in the day. The other shout-out was, again, to my friend Eric Eagleton, my greatest mechanic ever, actually bought the garage. So when you need a car guy who's on your side, go down and see Eric at Grassland Car Care. Okay, now, for those of you listening not here and from around the country as well, with us in the studio, gosh, time's going to go by so quickly, that's why I'm talking fast, is the amazing Diane Canada. You knew her from as a political figure, darling, of both the right and, turns out, those on the left, too. You just got to get to know each other. Diane, you with us?
With you. Hey, thanks, Wes.
Hey, listen, I want to ask you a couple questions about your house and remodel. You're the perfect person to do this with, obviously, because you have no problem communicating, and the time's going to fly by. You had a complete 100% total house makeover, right?
Yes.
What's that? Okay, what's the age of the house?
It was built in 68.
Is it a ranch-style house?
It is. Mm-hmm. One of those long brick ranches.
Okay. And by the way, in the business, so you look like you know me, those are called ramblers. And you, back in the 60s and 70s, late 50s, 60s and 70s, if you were like a really rich, like a doctor or a surgeon or like a country music singer like Hank, you bought a rambler while the commoners lived in the ranch house, right?
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't know that. Oh, yeah. A rambler. Okay. Yeah.
I've got,
I like it.
I've got one of those houses, and they are the very, 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 very best built houses in the history of our trends in housing, in the history of our country. They are hard to take apart. They're easy to do additions because they're so strong. When you decided to do the whole house thing, you and your husband, how much planning did you do? How much input did you have? Did you use an architect?
So we had a unique situation. This was a house that my husband had owned for about 15 years, mm-hmm. and it was just kind of sitting here, and it was kind of a transient house for different people in the family who needed. He never really lived here, you know, in the traditional sense.
Right.
We were going to sell it, and his mom took. She had, unfortunately, Parkinson's and Parkinson's induced dementia, and she had reached a point where she just needed full-time care. Well, after the election was over, I had some time on my hands, and I said, I'll go. You know, Brian and I just decided to come out and take care of her in her final days. And so when we moved in, it was sort of everything kind of happened very fast.
Okay.
So we didn't have any time to plan. It was one of those,
no way,
she needs us now. Yeah. And when I got here, literally I would open doors, Wes, and I would just cry because it would be like, oh my God, like where do we even start? Because this house had just been, had great bones, but it had been so neglected. Nobody really taking care of it for all that time.
Well, if you're going into it, Diane, without necessarily a plan and an architect, what about the budget? Certainly you had to budget.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we had a bit of a budget. I mean, this house was at the time, you know, completely paid off, and so we ended up taking out some equity, an equity loan in it, and we ended up using that to, help us afford the remodel. And we're not done. I mean, we've got it to a place now where we're going to start adding on more additions and things like that. But it was just a matter of getting it livable and getting it functional, you know. And so there was just, I mean, we say to this day, I don't know how we did it. I don't know how we did it while taking care of her.
Were you guys, I went through that too recently, not only with my folks, but with some elderly neighbor, good friends of mine. did you want and basically did you just get everything kind of new, or were you doing it to do some really special spaces, like, hey, I want a man cave over here, or I want this kitchen to be this way, or was it simply that we wanted it new and functional?
Well, at that time, it was a matter of we ripped up floors, we did all new, like, thank God it was built so well. That, I mean, you're right when you say it's built like rock solid strong. So these walls, it you just can't kill this house. You know, it's so strong.
Right. Yeah.
But there were things we couldn't do, so we had to bring in contractors. We did a lot of landscape clearing, you know, like a lot of, trees and shrubbery that had grown up and all that. We did a lot of stuff outside. We're on a couple of acres out here. And then we had all new floors put in, you know, kitchen. We did that vinyl laminate, luxury vinyl tile, whatever they call it, in the kitchen. And we did all new, we love carpet, so yeah. I know we're, you know, old school, but we did some all new carpet. We did knock out some walls, and we restructured some things, but we still have more to do. We want to put an ensuite. We turned what was originally, a carport, it had been turned into a den, and now we've turned into a large bedroom with a fireplace and all
Even
in it.
Better.
So we're going to build an ensuite off of that, hopefully this year. And, you know, we've got some plans for adding on. I'd love to put a pool in the backyard. We put a patio in and a pergola and stuff like that.
When you get the pool, Diane, when you get the pool, I'll be out. I'll come out. And now, listen, we've only got a couple minutes left, so I want to touch on Reunite America Academy. But first of all, when it comes to this house thing and everything we're doing at the house, who has the ultimate say, you or the husband?
Of course, the woman has to say. The man may be the head of the house, but the woman turns the neck.
Yeah, she's got the con for sure. Now, let me see. I'm looking at the clock, watching it. Ruben's going to come in and tell me 2 minutes, in about 2 minutes from now. Reunite America Academy, you had just launched it in 30 seconds or less. Tell us what it is.
Yeah, so the Academy sits on an app that we just released called Lady Up America. So people
Lady
can
Up.
Go to the Google or the iTunes stores, look up Lady Up America app, and on that sits the Reunite America Academy. What we're doing is we're teaching everyday, ordinary moms, savvy moms and women, how to become masterful influencers in today's tough political climate without getting political.
Wow. So let me get this right. You're teaching them how to be powerful, the way to think, the way to handle without being political. And you're teaching them how to do that.
The conversations have never been tougher, right? So people, like I said earlier, they're either opting out of conversations with people with opposing views, or they try to stand for what they believe, but it ends up in a fight, right? It ends up erupting into a fight.
Right.
We have a third option. So our third option is, don't be afraid of these conversations. We're going to teach you how to have finesse and to have a real genuine care and concern and compassion for people. So we restore civility. We're bringing people to a place where they're not afraid of these conversations and they're not erupting into fights. Mm-hmm. We're able to earn permission to be heard. And then that's how you gain influence with someone, is you've got it. What did Maya Angelou say? People don't care what you know until they know how much you care.
We talk about that every week here. But all right. So when you first came on back in Snowmageddon, and I'm telling you, time's really flying. Let's be conscious of the clock. But how is your progress? How's it going? Is it better than you expected? Is it slower than you expected? What have you learned that,
Well, I'm happy to say that we've been tweaking it a little bit as we've gone. So we haven't done a whole lot to push it and promote it because we were still fine-tuning it.
Uh-huh.
But now it is at a point where I feel like we can push it. So we've got about 100 downloads right now on it, not very many, you know, but that's okay, because the people that have been doing it, we're doing these workshops every 2 weeks where people are coming in and getting to practice what they're learning on the app. And so that's helped us fine tune it and see what do people need
sure.
on that app. So now that we've got it doctored up good and we feel like it's ready for prime time, now we'll start really getting behind the marketing efforts and pushing it.
Now, another thing too is, thank you, Ruben, we've got, I've got about a minute, but what I'm going to do is we're going to launch our thing, and I have the very, very best SEO genius in the world. We've got online courses. We've got all these podcasts that we're doing. We've got forums and so forth, and this thing's going to be big. It's going. He's going to make this thing be number one everywhere. I want to put a link to your app, Reunite America Academy, on my website, and then if your viewers and visitors want to look like a really good-looking guy, they can click on my link.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah, I'm selfless that way. Yeah.
Yeah, and I want to just clarify, the Reunite America Academy
oh, yeah.
fits on the app. So the place that they would go would be ladyupamerica.com.
All right. It's hard sometimes for the transmission. It's Lady Up, just like what's up, but Lady Up. I like that.
Yeah, Lady Up. Got a Lady Up, girls. Lady Up, America.
Listen, it's Easter weekend, and music's about to start, and this may end up getting, some of this might get edited out, but Diane, I'm so grateful that you're in my life, that I can call you a friend. My life is so good, and it's because I'm surrounded by good people.
Thank you. I feel the same way about you, and thank you so much for having me on. I always enjoy visiting with you and with Ruben, so
Ruben gets a shout out.
Coffee time this morning. Yeah.
Well, he and you are both the coffee people. I've just had water this morning. That's why I'm trying to keep up over here. All right. Thanks, Diane, for coming on. Guys, I'm Wes Taylor. We're going to be back next week at 8 o'clock. We'll be back next week. And then I think the week after is when I'm out of town. We'll get that squared away. I'm so glad you're with us. I'm Wes Taylor. See you next week.